afternoon, everyone. Hello, good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. I want to appreciate the organizers of TEDxAkure for this privilege to be here today. While they try to get my presentation on, my name is Olusola Amusan. I was born in a small town in Osun State, in Nigeria, called Modakeke, a place where at the time I was born, was probably not more than 20,000 to 25,000 people. And over time, I grew in a family where there wasn't so much of sukkah, there wasn't so much of prosperity, there wasn't so much of abundance. But values such as discipline and dignity were the hallmarks of existence. And I did learn a whole lot of things growing up through inter-county crisis and a couple of other things like that. Today I'm going to be talking about something I find quite interesting. When the organizers told me that we were to talk in line with the theme, which is thinking the future. So I'll be talking about time machine today. And I'm going to bust your bubble because I'm not talking about some new technological advancements called time machine that can make you teleport into the future or some good stuff that can make you go back into the past. You know, I saw a movie recently where somebody, okay, I think the title is Bathtub Time Machine. How many of us? These three friends went to a particular hotel to rest and then they saw a bathtub, entered the bathtub, and it took them back to the past, about 30 years earlier. And so they saw themselves really young again, and they found out that they could change the future from the past. So one of them, who had seen Google before, changed, quickly innovated something like Google, okay, and changed it, and by the time they got back to the present, he had become one of the richest guys in the world. Okay, so I'm not talking about that time machine today. I'm going to talk about something that is so dear to my heart about young people in Africa, especially those who have found themselves, those who have decided to pay attention to critical development and advancement. You can see that this all is more filled today. So I am so going to be particular, not about people who are not doing something about their lives, but about those who are already trying to do something to change community, to change society, to change their lives and the lives of people around them. So I'm going to talk about the time machine. Peculiar among some of the things I learned quite very early in life is how to stay years ahead of my peers. I learned quite early in life how to do things that people who were around my age group were not doing. So, as a matter of fact, some of the few things I've done in the past 4 or 5 years are a result of that paradigm. The thought that if I can find out what should be done years to come, and I can position myself aright to start doing some of those things, then certainly I can become somebody relevant, and I can make society enjoy from the sukkah that I've been able to create. About 50 years ago, nobody was talking about business and technology, internet, communications, laptops, you know, Blu-ray discs. People weren't talking about network computers and things like that. But a couple of people who were thinking about these things decided to position themselves and start doing something about it. While I was sitting right there just before I stood up, something popped up into my mind. And what popped up into my mind is, despite the fact that as Africans, we can imagine that we are backward and we are not on the same level with the rest of the world, a thought popped into my mind that what if we could think of ourselves as equally opportune individuals, as members of the 21st century who have access to the internet, who have access to laptop computers, who have access to over 10 billion pages of information that circulates on the internet every day, who has access to the massive amount of knowledge that reinvents and changes itself every 18 months all world over, who has access to MIT's open courseware on the internet for free, if we can begin to imagine ourselves as people who have equal opportunities with some other people all around the world because of the age that we're fortunate to find ourselves in? Would we make different choices? Would we decide to do things differently? If again we can think that, after all, the same way somebody in Harvard has access to the internet, they came forward to talk about the Kinect, and it's one of the things that amazes me the most. So if every one of us in this room today can begin to think of the opportunities we have, and not think about the opportunities that we don't have, and we start acting on those opportunities we have, then our Africa, our own Africa, will become a better place. The same way some folks can think of changing their own world, then we can change our own Africa. So since we weren't talking about this 50 years ago, what we should be doing is to think about what people will be thinking about, or what people will be needing 50 years time. Essentially, what this means is that what you and I should be doing is not just to be enjoying the benefits of technology, or to be enjoying the comfort of the discoveries made by the West, not just to be people who test the experiments of China and India, but to be people who can also sit down and think about what can or what will be needed in the future. I read some time ago that in 2017, the consumption of fossil fuel all around the world will drop because of the Green Revolution. And that in 2036 or so, or 2037, there will no more be crude oil in Nigeria. So would somebody sit down and think about what essentially would be needed in those years to come? Those are the people that will be able to take charge of the future. In the early 80s, Bill Gates, Paul Allen, and a couple of other people sat down, created a baby called Microsoft that has grown so much today to feed not only the economy of America, but to bring a lot of peace and tranquility to the turmoils of Africa. So young men like you and I can begin to imagine, despite the odds that confront us today, and sit down and imagine what will be needed in 20 years to come, what will be needed in 30 years to come, so that as there is about to be a revolution in 2017, the Green Revolution, as there is about to be a change, young men like you and I can be the pioneers of that change. We can be those who will extend the frontiers of that change to people not only in the civilized cities of Nigeria. 828 million people still live in slums all around the world. That's close to 1 billion people all around the world. So I'm not challenging you to take some solution that will be so good for the city. Some solution that will be so good for Lagos and Abuja and Port Harcourt. I had some opportunity to talk with a rep from Ashoka US sometimes last year. And one thing that amazed them so much during the about 18 minutes conversation we had on the phone was that, why would you choose to do your own work in a city like Akure that has no refinery, that has no oil company, that has no telecommunication company headquarters or bank headquarters? You know what my response was is that we should stay where problems are more prevalent. So my challenge to us today is that we will begin to think of what is next. Like the time machine, imagine that we travel into the future. That you and I can begin to sit down and wear our thinking caps and travel far 30 years ahead to think about what will be needed. What will be needed? It is for the people of 2012 and beyond to know that technology, as we have already known, or as I suppose that we know, that technology change our words that go pari passu. That is, things will continually change. Nobody will sit down to continue to, especially if they are not in Africa, except in Africa. It's only in Africa that we just want to sit down and consume what the West is doing, what China is doing, what India is doing, what other countries all around the world is doing. But people in China are not sleeping. People in America are not sleeping. I was talking to a friend this afternoon and I said, I don't want to raise my kid in a city that sleeps. I said, I want to raise my children in a city that does not sleep. Now, that might be some future kind of thoughts, but it is fundamental to my existence. Okay? And I'm saying this because if we just sit down and celebrate Kinect and celebrate the fantastic ideas that Microsoft is churning out, that Oracle is producing, that all the great guys at Silicon Valley are doing, and we refuse to create our own realities, then we will leave our children and the future generations to come to begin to still continue to be slaves of civilization, to be slaves of organization, and to stand behind in the global scheme of things. Nice in that slide. So I'm going to share a couple of vital thoughts that come to my mind while I talk about the time machine. One of it is the loophole theory. I learned this from a mentor of mine, and what he believes, this particular loophole theory, he created it and then he sold it to Mercedes-Benz, and Mercedes-Benz saw it as a fundamental theory. The loophole theory believes that everything is not without a loophole, and everything has a loophole. That is, every level of success has a critical loophole to be occupied. That is, in every camera, in every book, in every speaker, in every projecting system, there is a loophole, and that loophole is the opportunity for future advancement. So somebody needs to sit down and look at the chair he's sitting on and see that there is an opportunity for critical advancement there. For every machine, for every appliance, for every software we use, there is no perfection. There is no perfection because there must be opportunity for future generations to research. There must be opportunity for future generations to work on. The same way, the things we use today, we must begin to observe and critically analyze the loopholes in these things. And in whatever area we find ourselves, in agriculture, in technology, in programming, in software development, in a corporate social responsibility, in law, or wherever we find ourselves, we must begin to know that there are loopholes that needs to be filled. Then everything we create that must be solid enough in the 21st century must be of universal appeal. If whatever principle we operate with, whatever ideas, whatever discoveries, whatever inventions we come up with cannot be of universal appeal, then we are not yet doing anything fantastic. Thank God, because there are folks in this room who have international exposure, and they would have seen that there is no such thing as an idea that there is no such value as an idea that only tackles a problem that does not affect the global scale. This is what I mean. That every problem that is solved, that whatever solution you give, must have in some way either adding to global peace, ensuring that the world is a better place, or doing something great on the global scheme of things. So whatever we are doing, the strength of any material is in its universal appeal. You can't take an alligator to America because it's a Nigerian alligator and it becomes a lizard in America. If it becomes a lizard in America, it's either there is something wrong with the definition of your alligator or there is something wrong at all. A shoe cannot be a telephone in the US. Okay? You can't say you created a phone here and it becomes a singlet when you take it to India. There's a problem somewhere. So everything we do must be of universal appeal. And then you need to seize the future. We all need to seize the future. Nobody is ready, even Bill Gates is not ready to release the future to us. He decided to seize the future from the mainframe guys. That's why he created the Microsoft. So we as individuals must also decide to seize the future from those who are doing fantastic things today. We must continually grow and make junkie of self-development. So we must get ourselves into the cocoon of addictive growth, continually growing, knowing that what we have today is not the best we can have. Consistently beating our records and getting better. And consistency is important. As you keep growing, you must be consistent in whatever you're doing so that your niche can be understood and your brand can be eventually celebrated. And when you are consistent, take it to the level of significance. When you take it to the level of significance, it means you're not just thinking about yourself. You're not just thinking about having some money in the bank and being able to travel to US for summer, but you are doing something that can affect thousands of other people who need to eat. 2,500 children die of hunger every day in Africa. They died yesterday, they are dying today, they will die tomorrow. So you and I must begin to think and provide solutions that would affect these people, okay? And then we must seek to leave a legacy behind. Now after all, when we are done, after all has been said and done, after you've worked so hard, there must be something that future generations will be able to look out for and say, yes, indeed, these guys did something fantastic. In dignity, they labored. Thank you for your time. Thank you for the opportunity. We must position ourselves as thinking time machines. Thank you so much.